Welcome again to the show, Your December to Remember. It's nice to hear you talking. Yeah, I think we can talk a little bit about our inner world, and there's so much going on in there. We have feelings, we have emotions. Yeah, how did you end up, or actually start, where do we start in this world inside of us, related to, of course, the world we live in? In a month, in a celebrity, in a festive season, where people want all things to be right and cozy and like the ideal picture, but in reality, it's sometimes not at all as we expect it to be.
Yes. Yeah. Thank you for inviting me to the show. Also, again, I'm really glad to be here and to explore these possibilities with you. And I really appreciate for you to say that there's this really this wish, I think, in all of us, and I would say maybe even more these days, to meet with our loved ones, our families, a partner, and have a nurturing time, have a finally a loving time, a nurturing time. And there's this, what we usually forget is that we, you know, for example, we in the car and we're going to the parents or parents-in-law or something like that, and there's all this what we call the middle world that we had to handle. So we in the car, the kids are dressed, we have the food, you know, and so we're going, and the hope is we're going to move from this middle world of logistic into this upper world of love and presence and gifts and wonderfulness. And what happens is that we ring the doorbell. You know, you can do this experiment. You ring the doorbell, like you ring a stopwatch. And the moment you ring the doorbell, you start the stopwatch and you notice the door opens. You notice the moment you get hooked into your underworld, which is, you know, you're irritated, you're annoyed, you know, your mother is like holding your cheek, you know, are you eating enough, you know, oh, you're late. And immediately there's this whole experience of resentment and broken expectation. And this is called the underworld. And so we have this imagination that we can move from the middle world, you know, directly into the upper world without owning what I called our underworld. You know, you're talking about our inner world, which is owning what we're irritated about, or what we, you know, what we're resentful about, and actually to be able to own this as, oh, okay, this is a part of me, actually opens the door to the ability of presence and love and connection.
Okay.
And so I do want to talk about something else, but I just wanted to bring it up so that people, the people listening, you have a map of which world are you in, what's happening.
I think it really would be helpful for people so that they know that they will be invited by their feelings to this underworld, but they actually can prepare themselves like, okay, let's go through some of these emotions before I go there, and then, right?
Yeah, and so, especially if the people you were listening, you've listened to the first interview that we did with Margaret, is there's this important distinction that you're bringing, Margaret, about the distinction between feelings and emotion. Mm-hmm. And so feelings are anger, sadness, fear, and joy. Like I said, those pure feelings that actually emerge in the present and that you can use for your everyday life in the present. So they come up, you use them, and they go away.
Yeah.
And if you're feeling anger, sadness, fear, or joy, or mixed emotion, like depression, or isolation, or jealousy, or greed, or resentment, with that mixed emotion, they come up, you try to do something, you try to change something in your life, and the emotion remains. Whatever you do, it does not go away. So it's this, you know, have you ever had the experience of being angry, and then an hour later, you're still angry? Or a week later, you're still angry. Or a year later, you're still angry about that thing. Well, that means that's an emotion. And it's a very useful distinction to make when you start working with your emotional body and your heart of feelings are for handling things. Emotions are for healing things. They're not bad. The emotions are not bad. They're a gateway for emotional healing process and actually have nothing to do with try to change things, try to make use of them in your relating in the immediate present. And so one of the hints that I use is when I feel an emotion coming and this has nothing to do with the person I'm talking. This is from, you know, my mom or my dad, or I have in my beat book. So I have a little book that I carry everywhere with me. And the last page, I have emotional healing process. And I write down, I felt angry and what the anger was about. And then I have a team that I can call up and say, hey, I need somebody to hold space for me for an emotional healing process. And it's just fabulous. Time spent with other people who are willing to hold space for my healing, and then I do it for them. And we're journeying like that together.
Go.
Well, something that I really discovered recently is that the context, what I thought, the cultural environment that we were born and raised in has really this limitation of how much the quality and the depth and the intensity of how much intimacy and connection is possible. And it's mostly I discovered because the values of what I called modern culture is mostly to know and to be right. So this is school. We've just learned that in school. We spent 14 years in school is do you know the answer and give the right answer. And that really spreads over and contaminates also how we relate. And so we think that the most important thing in relating is I need to know myself, know who you are. I need to know who the other person is, what they like, what they don't like, what do they eat in the morning? How do they react to this? I know them. And also being right in a conversation. So that's, and really it limits our ability to be intimate to this intellectual bantering, really this mind to mind, which is really a war to war. Is I have the right answer or, you're wrong. Mm-hmm. And it's, and so what happens often is that either the people we surround ourselves with, our friends, is the people who agree, agree with what we know. And this is what we call our friends. Mm-hmm. And then the enemies is the people who we disagree with. And so all our space of relating, our relationship are based on this mental survival need to know who I am, know the other people and be right. And that completely, it puts a ceiling on what connection could really be like. And I think most people who are listening, somehow you've had an experience of a different kind of connection where by accident you found yourself in a place where you had a really deep conversation. It's been a nourishing conversation. It's been, you were discovering something about yourself or about the other person. And that could have been, 5 minutes, but also hours. And the thing is, often we find the way to these nourishing connection by accident. And my proposal here is to actually give possibility for you to create them whenever you want. And the experiment, the proposal, the invitation that I'm making is to shift from this importance of knowing and being right to, for example, going on an adventure. So instead of being, I know who I am, it's I'm going to go on an adventure with my partner, my children, my parents, and to open the gates to letting yourself discover yourself anew every day. I mean, every day, but I would say even every 3 seconds.
Yeah.
Because we are a complex creature. Things are moving all the time. We're learning. We're discovering. We're thinking. So actually, every 3 seconds, sort of like every breath, we could be discovering something new about ourselves, but also something new about our partner. And it's sort of the idea of, would you rather, wake up in the morning and get out of bed and say, okay, he's gonna wake up and he's gonna go pee and he's gonna want to have this coffee this way, and you know, and it's just the same routine every morning, or waking up in the morning and turning around and say, hi, I would like to meet you today. Yeah. You know, who are you? What happened? Yeah. who have you become while we were sleeping? Yeah. And to go on these adventures.
Yeah, that's beautiful. I think to every day, because we know the expression, of course, every day is a new day, and today is my favorite day. And you can say this every day, right? Because we are alive. But to say to each other, like to see each other also as a new you, you know, that's beautiful. Because
yeah, and I want to share some very practical ideas about what this could look like, because yeah. You know, it could be that you know, we spend like 20, 30, 40, 50 years into this prison, really, this really tight prison of almost, you know, not being able to breathe, really, of surviving by playing it safe. So having this routine where everything is. And so, for example, it could be very small experiments, offers. These are offers for intimacy that you make, but you're in this shopping mall and everybody's shopping and it's a crazy Christmas and you're with your partner and you can feel the stress of time and money and having to do all that. And you just look at your partner and you hold their hand and you say, I want to do a slow waltz with you here, just in the middle of the shopping mall, the shopping street, for 5 minutes. And you just put all the bags down and you put your hand, you know, on your partner and you just dance for 5 minutes, you know, and finally presence happen. And so that's a discovery of, oh, who can we be when we're dancing together? But it can also be really this shift of identity of you in the morning, you're in the kitchen, you know, making coffee. Hey, just start singing your favorite latest song, just out loud. You know, yeah. And I know from experience that when a woman is singing in the kitchen, you know, being a woman, it fills the space with so much love.
Yes, that's true.
And the children and the you know, the men, it's just, God, there's so much love in the space. But it can also be, you know, you're driving in the car and you're the passenger. I offered for not the driver to do the experiment, but you're the passenger and you start telling the story where your partner is the main character. He's the, you know, he's the hero, she's the heroine of the story. It's a 15 to 20 minute story where you reveal to your partner the things that you notice about her qualities, you know, her, I would call her archetypal qualities, you know, her being qualities. And you just design this story where she's battling monsters and saving children and that's it. You just, and at the end, you just say, you know, thank you very much. And something else is you could go around and you don't even have to just do this with your partner or your children, but even with the cashier, you know, who's overwhelmed and stressed out, and just look at them and you say, I appreciate your commitment for people to be able to buy gifts that will, you know, create connection in their life. And you are, you know, dedicating your time that they can buy these things so that they can have the Christmas that they want. Mm-hmm. And just look at them. So yeah. It's not about what they're doing. You know, it's not about, oh, you're packing the gifts so well, because that's a doing thing. And it's not about what they have. So, you know, oh, you have a great car, or you have great clothes. Because this is so limiting in terms of appreciation. Yeah. It's a form of manipulation, actually, you know. But to appreciate the qualities of the beings, and it is so obvious, you know, the qualities of beings, actually. And so, you know, for example, Margaret, I appreciate your enormous kindness in spending, you know, making use of your time and your you know, the love of the people, but the possibility to open the door for possibility that people could connect, could create more love in their life. So yeah. you're completely dedicated to more love happening. And this is, it's completely generous and kind, you know, and not that it matters or not, but you're not getting paid for this. Your reward, the payment is, will people create more love in their home over Christmas? And so
it's nice. It's nice to hear you. I feel it's nice when you hear somebody saying it to you. That's true. We can share appreciation much more, huh? I mean,
but the thing is, I didn't know that until I started appreciating you. Because I really appreciate about Margaret? And then all these dimensions started unfolding and I could keep
while
going.
While talking, yeah.
Yes, while talking. And I think this is, it's such a natural ability that we have as human beings, is to see these qualities of presence. What happens when somebody walks in the room? How can they change the atmosphere? What is brought in? You know, is it love? Is it generosity? Is it community? Is it possibility? Is it, and to just really talk about this.
Yeah.
And so that goes through, because these are experiment. I call them adventurous connection experiment. So you can have an adventurous connection day. You know, you could say to your partner, hey, let's have an adventurous connection day. And the entire day you're creating possibility and experiment to discover, you know, both of yourself and you. And this, it is based on the values that are completely different from modern culture, where the whole knowing and being right is so overrated. I mean, it's so, in a way, become so disgusting that's been our only ability to be with each other and to be, God, actually, I can have adventures. I can explore. I can discover by opening these doors to this different kind of intimacy. And you just go through the ceiling, right through the ceiling of what was limiting your ability to be intimate, and all these flavors and dimensions come alive.
Yeah, and I really think and listening to you, that's also for the listeners, that's to trust that this works, right? I mean, people will need to refine their courage to ask these kind of questions, because a partner might say, what's going on with you know me, you know, there will be this wall. But to tap into courage and talk from appreciation and be the first to reach, who's reaching out for more depth. It is so vast, the possibility of to find more joy instead of being afraid that you look silly because you ask more a deeper question. I mean, you're sharing beautiful examples.
That's when you can go back to the first video, the first experiment, where you say, hey, I'm afraid of doing, you know, of making this offer because I'm you might think I'm silly.
Yeah.
And at the same time, I want to experiment with new things with you. Yeah. And so here's my offer. And so, I want to say, I want to offer this possibility for the people listening to watch the movie, if you're movie watchers, to watch the movie called Don Juan de Marco with Johnny Depp and Marlon Brando. And that movie is an exceptional jewel of how a different quality of intimacy is possible put at the center of your culture, you know, really the center of your relationship to the world and relationship to other people, something else than knowing, something else than having a box around you. And then the box is very familiar, but it's completely dead, completely mechanical. And in that, intimacy is so limited. Yeah. And so really what I say is, intimacy, or extraordinary intimacy, adventurous intimacy, happens at the edge of your box, you know, at the edge of this identity you created for yourself. And at this edge, this is where the adventures can begin. But at this edge, you don't know, you know, you enter this domain of not knowing.
That's great. I'm a big fan of the unknown, because it's really like how you have this, Le Petit Prince, you know, on the globe, this famous image of Le Petit Prince. He's also on the edge of planet Earth, it's like looking into this universe. I mean, that's almost how it is, right? If we indeed step away from our from the identity we created around ourselves and enter, walk towards the edge, trying different questions, different way of looking at things, less labeling.
Yeah, I mean, I think one of the biggest fear that people might have of, like you said, walking to this edge, discovering who you are without this box, is this fear of, I will be alone. Nobody will understand me and I will be alone. And I just want to say that there's really millions. There's a man, Paul Ray, and his partner, I can't remember the name, who did this research about this cultural creative, the people who are building new culture and next culture. And 20 years ago, there was already 300 million people in the world who were on this edge. And the thing they had in common was they all felt alone. And he was like, but there's 300 million people who are doing this.
Yeah.
And so I really want to say that there's teams that are being built of people who want to do this experiment, who want to walk on the edge, who want to discover who they are. And you can connect right into them. And usually their arms are right open. They're like, yeah, yes, join us. We're on this discovery journey. And so the more the merrier.
Great. So, yeah.
Well, and the links for these teams, at least the possibility management teams, will be put in the video.
Well, I think it's great to end with that we're not alone. You're not alone. Yeah. And sometimes people feel very alone in community, within their small families, within their lost somewhere on the street in big crowds. But there is a way to find connection. And I think that's beautiful. And you've been sharing wonderful examples and exercises. Thank you very much, because it's I love this idea of indeed being in the car and just start telling a story, invent a story about one of the persons who is driving with you. I mean, yeah, that's beautiful. And that's creating the memories we actually want to create, I think, mm-hmm. and long for also. So thank you for this nourishment and all the work you do, Anne, because I hope 300 million are coming and looking for it.
Yeah.
Walking through the edge. Yes.
Yeah. Thank you so much, Margaret, for planting all these seeds and opening these doors to possibilities for all of us around the world.
Thank you very much. Well, we'll stay in touch, and I make sure people can find you and your work. And
thank you.
I wish you a wonderful December and already Happy New Year.
Yeah. Thank you, Margaret.
Full of surprises.
Bye.
Bye-bye.